Yeah, thank you, Dave. I actually, last 2 days, I've been having a lot of fun, attending a lot of classes, trying to set students on the straight and narrow, although, if any of you end up wanting bail money, it's not my fault. Dave had asked me to spend a little bit of time, just talk about my background. My decision to attend Eureka, it was purely practical. I graduated from Washington High School just down the road, and attending Eureka, I was able to live at home, work full time, and so as a result, I had a car, I had money, and I graduated debt free, which doesn't happen with most college students. While I was going to Eureka, these microphones are not. I've got more wires than an electrician here. Okay. While I was going to Eureka, the first couple of years I worked at St. Francis Hospital. The last 2 years I worked at Proctor Hospital. Probably one of the biggest highlights of my going to Eureka was that I was fortunate enough to work with Steve Binkley, who Venom Binkley Hall is named after. Here's a picture of Dr. Binkley. Steve always loved being in the lab. Whenever I started my sophomore year here at Eureka, there was a scuttlebutt about we're getting a new science and math chairman in, and that was Steve. And I was just entering my sophomore year. Just like today, all of the professors at the college, they all had their own student assistant. And even though I was just starting my sophomore year, I figured, okay, I'll apply for the position as his assistant. I probably won't get it. And I was surprised. I became Steve's student assistant. Actually, let me go back to this. I think everybody who worked with Steve had their own favorite Binkley story. I actually have two. The first story, I started working as Steve's student assistant. I'd worked with Steve for a couple months, and it's a 12-hour a week thing. And he was teaching me all kinds of great lab techniques, some really neat chemistry, and I'm thinking, wow, this guy really knows his chemistry. Well, one Saturday, we were cleaning out the storeroom over in the science building, and somebody told me it's a lot the same way today where there are bottles that are almost 120 years old and you can't read the labels. But Steve and I were trying to deal with this stuff. And at the end of the day, Steve says, hey, come on over to my house. I'll cook us up some burgers. So I went over to Steve's house with him. He and his wife, Lois, were in the kitchen. And I was looking at one of his bookcases. And on the books, I start seeing this Binkley, Binkley, Binkley. So, Lois came out of the kitchen and she says, asked me if I wanted something to drink. And I says, hey, Lois, did Steve write all these books? And she says, well, yeah, he wrote some of them. Actually, he edited most of them. And, I asked her, I said, Lois, Steve, he doesn't talk about himself. What did he do before he came to Eureka? And she says, oh, well, for about the last 20 years, he's been chairman of biochemistry at the University of Illinois up in Chicago, and he's also been dean of the graduate college. And that was the first notion that I got that I was working with somebody pretty, pretty hot. And then Lois says, I told her how impressed I was. She says, oh, no, you want to be impressed, come over here. So she trots me over to the other side of the living room. There's this big picture of Steve and two other guys standing in Stockholm, Sweden, being awarded the Nobel Prize. And Steve had never mentioned any of that. He was, you know, one of the most humble, quiet people that you could imagine. You know, my second Binkley story is in my senior year at Eureka, where, you know, I'm getting ready to leave Eureka. Went, sat down, talked to Steve. You know, here's a guy, he's been incredibly successful, famous scientist, the whole shot. And, you know, I asked him, I said, you know, if you were me, what would you do? And he says, well, you know, I'd go to the University of Illinois up in Chicago, and I'd work in the microbiology department. And, you know, my reaction was, oh, man, I don't even like microbiology. Because, you know, microbiology is growing smelly stuff on petri dishes. You know, it was not something, you know, I was a chemist. So, you know, Steve says, no. No, he says, it's not what you think. He says, the program up there, he says, it's probably the only program in the world right now that's training people in immunology and molecular biology. So I applied to the program. And a few weeks later, I got a nice rejection letter. So, you know, I went back to Steve's office and I says, hey, Steve, you know, what's game plan number two? Because, you know, I didn't get into the program up there. Steve says, have a seat. Let me make a phone call. So Steve made about a 3-minute phone call. He gets off the phone. He says, okay, I just talked to Sheldon Dre. He's chairman of the department up there. He wants to meet you for lunch on Monday. And he said, congratulations on being accepted into the program. Now, Steve was quite a guy. He was class of 34, spent a lot of his career at University of Illinois. He was here at Eureka for 13 years. Like I said, I mean, he was a member of a team that won the Nobel Prize, highly successful. He actually authored one of the best-selling biochemistry books in the world. And it was not on the New York Times bestseller list, but it was used by most medical students for about 10 years. And he is the namesake of Venom Binkley Hall. Okay, now me. My career is not as good as Steve's, but here it is. I came out of Eureka in 75, went to the University of Illinois, graduated from there in 1980, spent 4 years at the University of Southern California in Los Angeles, 2 years as a postdoc, 2 on the faculty. That was when I jumped into industry. My first stint was with the Allied Signal Corporation for a couple years. And then I went to work and spent a number of years at Boehringer Mannheim, which is Roche today. I actually ended up in senior management at Boehringer Mannheim. And, you know, those of you who know me, you know, I'm the type, I like to have fun. And dressing like this every day and sitting in a conference room 10 hours a day in meetings is not fun. And that was when I decided I wanted to get into small biotechnology. I started looking around for small companies that I could hook up with. There was actually a small company in Buffalo, New York named Cellular Products. And Cellular Products, they were owned by a bigger company, but the bigger company, Cellular Products, they'd never made a profit. And so the parent company, they were looking for somebody to come to Buffalo and really fix things. And, you know, to me, it looked like a challenge. So I took off for Buffalo. In 1999, I founded ZeptoMetrix, and here's how all that happened. Now, back to Cellular Products. This was a company that started in 1982. Their business goal was to have the world's first AIDS test. And they actually did have one of the world's first AIDS tests. They were not the first, but their test was approved on the same day as Abbott Labs and Electronucleonics. A couple years later, they introduced the first human T-cell leukemia test. And, you know, but like I said, I mean, cellular products, the organization, it was never profitable. It was acquired by a company named Hemagen Diagnostics, and I actually moved to Buffalo to head up cellular products and see what I could do about fixing the thing. In 1999, Hemagen got into some very, very serious financial problems via lawsuits and things. So I called the CEO of Hemagen, and you know, I just asked him, I said, you know, how would you feel about selling the Buffalo operation? So, you know, his first response was, well, who wants to buy it? And I told him, I do. And he says, well, okay, I'll sell it to you if you can come up with the cash to do this. So I got together with a business partner. We both put in as much, well, I put in as much cash as I could. My business partner is fairly wealthy. He put in additional cash. We bought the business, renamed it ZeptoMetrix, and that's actually where ZeptoMetrix started. And my business partner and I, mean, we're 50-50 owners of the company. Within a year, we were running profitably, and we've been profitable and growing ever since. I mean, it's a slick business. Yeah, just as an aside, my business partner, he did a lot the same type of thing with the division of Westinghouse that he bought from Westinghouse, grew it over a 14-year period, sold it. You know, that's where all his money came from. The last 6 years, he spent four of the last 6 years as county executive for Erie County, New York. Right now, he's in the middle of a congressional race for the 26th district. And so life with him has been very interesting. Now, one other thing that we did is we were doing collaborative work in 2003 with a company named Bioclinical Partners. Bioclinical Partners, they're out of Franklin, Massachusetts. It's about 5 minutes from Gillette Stadium. They were owned at the time by Impath Corporation. Now, Impath got caught cooking their books. You know, they were faking their financials. They were a big public company. Their president and CEO both ended up with prison sentences by the time everything was said and done. Whenever the news broke of this, Impath stock went from about $65 a share down to about 40 cents in one day. And the class action lawsuits started. All the shareholders started suing to get their money back. So they filed Chapter 11, and they sold off, their core business was the pathology business. I mean, they had 600 pathologists on staff. They were the guys to go to for cancer diagnosis if you couldn't figure out what your patient had. A lot of pathologists would send samples to them just to confirm their suspicions on certain cancers. So, Impath had acquired Bioclinical Partners as kind of a small side business. Now, Impath, whenever the whole bankruptcy happened, the bankruptcy court made the decision, you know, the best thing to do with this whole thing is sell it off. So they sold the core pathology business to Genzyme, and they got a lot more money than they thought they would. And so what that left Bioclinical Partners, and it left a couple of smaller other companies, you know, just kind of hanging out there. And so, you know, the bankruptcy court, they looked at the whole thing. They said, well, we'll make an effort to sell these. You know, if push comes to shove, we'll just close them. So they called Chris, my business partner. They called Chris and I on a Friday night. And they said, you know, you guys, you're doing collaborative work with the guys at Bioclinical Partners. Yeah, it might make a lot of sense for you guys to buy them. And so, you know, we asked, we said, well, you know, what kind of money are you talking about? And they said, well, you're going to have to make an offer to us. But we'll tell you this, if we don't have some kind of agreement in place by Tuesday night, we're going to close it down on Wednesday. So, you know, needless to say, I mean, Chris and I got a real good deal on this thing. So today, ZeptoMetrix, we've got two facilities, the one in Buffalo, the one in Franklin, Massachusetts. We employ almost 80 people now. Eight of the people on staff besides myself have their PhDs. We're supplying products to pretty much every diagnostic company in the world today. We supply a lot of materials to proficiency organizations, and we also sell a lot of research products, products that we sell to research scientists, like some of the world's leading AIDS researchers are good customers of ours. Okay, our company motto is partner to our customer. You know, we don't feel it's good enough to talk to our customer or get to know our customer. I mean, we actually function as a real partner to our customers. I mean, the research scientists we deal with, the companies we deal with, we actually become part of their research programs when we get involved with them. From a technology standpoint, I mean, we're an infectious disease company. I mean, we work with a lot of very nasty stuff. We work with a lot of stuff other people don't want to work with. In terms of products, I mean, we've got our research products. We sell a lot of viruses and microorganisms. And everybody's probably sitting there saying, who buys that stuff? You know, it's a slick business. If a company like Abbott Laboratories up in Chicago is getting ready to introduce a new flu test, they'll call us and they'll say, okay, we need 50 different strains of flu virus grown up and purified. And we need it inactivated and shipped to us as quickly as possible. So we'll do projects like that. And we're one of the few commercial organizations in the world that can handle stuff like this. We have a huge collection of microorganisms, and we have roughly 4,000 different organisms sitting in our freezers. You know, some people collect stamps, some people collect coins. You know, we're into something a little different. Another thing that we do, and oh wow, there's a laser on this. I didn't realize that. Okay, I won't point this at anybody's eyes. Another thing that we do, in the Massachusetts operation, the business out there, it's a clinical specimens business. I mean, they have serum, plasma, urine, saliva, all sorts of samples from people with all sorts of infectious diseases. And they have about 1.5 million specimens in their collection right now. I mean, we in Buffalo collect infectious diseases, they collect nasty stuff from people who are infected. But again, this is a type of material that, you know, I'll bring up Abbott Labs again. If they're getting ready to put a new HIV test on the market, the FDA requires them to run about 50,000 HIV positive specimens. And going out and getting those yourself is a lot of work. But you can pick the phone up and you can call 1-800-ZeptoMetrix, and guess what? So, you know, we do a lot of things like that. The last two areas, I'm going to talk about them a little bit more detail in a few minutes. This is our PCR controls and our proficiency programs. Now, I mean, our customers are scientists. You know, scientists in hospitals, you know, research institutes, universities, and other companies. We do a lot of collaborative work with scientists from other organizations. I mean, this is just a handful of the people we work with. I mean, you can see the Centers for Disease Control and the NIH is right up here at the top. You know, I mean, we're involved in a big collaborative scientific effort worldwide on a lot of this stuff. We actually house the World Health Organization. We actually house their entire tuberculosis collection. We've got a number of certifications. I mean, all of the work we do has to be FDA compliant, largely because most of these products do go to pharmaceutical and diagnostic companies. The ISO certifications, those are our international certifications. that enable us to deal in Europe, Japan, places like that. We're an FDA registered blood establishment. And this last one here is kind of interesting. We have what's called a select agent permit. And a select agent permit, what that is, it's a permit that lets us work with things that could be biological weapons. I mean, we're licensed to work with anthrax, botulina, Yersinia pestis, which causes bubonic plague, whole collection of different organisms. We're one of the few commercial organizations in the world that holds one of these licenses. I've heard ZeptoMetrix described a lot of different ways. A few years ago, we were doing a big influenza project with the CDC, and that got profiled in the Wall Street Journal. And the reporter from the Wall Street Journal referred to ZeptoMetrix as the CDC's little shop of horrors. Okay. Now, this is our Buffalo facility. We've got our manufacturing building here and our office building here. This is our Massachusetts facility. This is about a 30,000 square foot facility here. And this is the view out of my office window. Okay, back up here in the back, you can see all these buildings back through here and in the distance. That's all Buffalo General Hospital, which is Kaleida's flagship hospital. This oval building here and all these other buildings here, that's all part of Roswell Park Cancer Institute. Roswell was actually the first cancer center in the United States. These buildings in through here and stretching back down that way are all university buildings. That's part of the State University of New York at Buffalo. And this thing that looks like a flying saucer here, that actually is a flying saucer. Okay, who believes that? Now, that's actually an institute. It's an interesting institute. It's the Hoffman Woodward Medical Research Institute. They're a three-dimensional crystallography institute where they're people that use crystallographic approaches, and they try and figure out how proteins and other molecules look on a three-dimensional level. And we're involved in a big project with them right now. With most viruses that infect us, we know what all the proteins are, and we know what the shape of all those proteins are. We just don't know how they all fit together. And so we've worked together with the guys at Hoffman Woodward, and we've actually figured out how to crystallize viruses. So, I mean, we're in the process right now of mapping out the three-dimensional structure of whole viruses. And, you know, it's exciting work in that, you know, if you get the structure of a whole virus and you've got two proteins that fit together like this, and you know how they fit together and you know what the contact points are, then you can actually design molecules that will prevent that from happening. And those can be very valuable antiviral drugs. I mean, this could be the next generation of antiviral drugs that we're developing. So, you know, we do a lot of basic scientific work like this. I mean, we really keep our nose to the grindstone, though, and support our customers and keep our product lines up. Okay, pictures are worth 1,000 words, so I've got a whole bunch of pictures. This is our manufacturing building in Buffalo. I always tell people when I show this slide, you see the amount of snow here? Okay, this picture was probably taken either early June or mid-September. By December, we could probably still see the windows in the top of the building. Now this building, it's three stories. The basement, first floor, and second floor are all laboratories. This is one of the laboratories in that building. This is one of our level three containment labs. With biosafety ratings, they're rated 1 through 4. I mean, 4 is the top. 4 is required for work with very deadly, highly contagious organisms. I mean, there are only a handful of those in the world, like Ebola virus. There's no commercial use to those. So our laboratories, they're all level three labs. The one lab actually is an enhanced level three, which is fairly close to level four. This lab here, we work with bloodborne viruses. That would be hepatitis, HIV, things like that. I mean, viruses that actually have to get into your bloodstream to cause an infection. All of this processing equipment here, this is all equipment we use. We work with hundreds of liters of viral cultures in these labs. And you have to process the cultures, concentrate the material. I mean, the first step in the purification process is we have to ultracentrifuge all this stuff. And you can't ultracentrifuge 100 liters. Well, actually you could. It would take about 6 months. So we concentrate the material using systems like this down to about a liter of material. That fits into an ultracentrifuge. And that's how we work with large quantities of these agents. This is another one of our containment labs. This is an enhanced level three laboratory. You can see the people in this lab, they're actually wearing full-blown spacesuits. These little packs on their backs, these are respirator packs that deliver sterile filtered air to the suits. We've got a lot of employees in the company that spend all day every day in spacesuits. And I actually enjoy working in these labs myself, largely because nobody can bother me. These are just some more pictures of that laboratory. This is one of our liquid nitrogen storage units. We keep all of our materials stored in liquid nitrogen. You know, all of the live materials that we use in the laboratories. So we've got smaller units. This is actually a pretty big unit. We call this our Ted Williams unit. Did everybody get that? No, and that's serious. We call it Ted. This is one of our conventional labs. These hoods here, these are biosafety hoods. And what they do is they actually deliver a sterile environment for you to work in. The airflow on the hoods is set up so that nothing gets outside of those hoods. And pretty much all the work that we do with any kind of biological in the building is done in these hoods. I mean, these hoods here, we're not working with infectious materials, but we are handling biologicals, so we work inside those cabinets. This is an automated extraction machine. We like to do a lot of our procedures automated just because, I mean, when you start pipetting and doing things by hand, you get a lot more variability in assays and procedures than you do with automated systems. I mean, we don't do it to save labor because you can see it takes two of these guys to load this thing. This is actually just a containment hood that we use for working with DNA. Now, this little gadget here, and I'll explain this a little bit more in a few minutes. This little gadget here, it's a real-time PCR machine. And the one that Pete's working with in this picture, this is one of eight machines in that room. The price tag on these is about $80,000 a piece. And we spend a fortune on our equipment. This is just an automated clinical chem analyzer. Okay, so inside the Franklin facility. The Franklin facility, we've got our big clinical specimen archive there, but a lot of the work that we do in that facility is packaging and filling. This machine here is just an automated labeling machine. You can see these plastic tubes here. This machine will label about 100 tubes a minute. This is an automated filling machine. This thing will handle about 50 tubes a minute and fill them and cap them. Just as a side note, we used to do this stuff by hand. And how many of you have pipetted stuff? Okay. pipetting 50,000 vials full of stuff is a horrible thing to do to your thumb. We invested a few hundred thousand dollars for each of these pieces of equipment, and you know they really have paid for themselves, because a lot of the work that we're doing, especially with our proficiency stuff, we may have to fill 30,000 vials at a pop. This is just a further back view of that. This is an automated packaging machine. Almost everything we ship out goes out on either cold packs or dry ice. This is a machine where we can take these little styrofoam clamshells, pop a cold pack in it, pop a few tubes or a box in it, close it up. This shrink wraps it and it's ready to go. Now, I mentioned the clinical specimen archive. This room here, these are minus 85 freezers. This room has row after row after row of these things. And we have about 60 freezers in this room. The air conditioning system for this room would buy about 10 Ferraris. Now, these things throw off a huge amount of heat. This is actually a drive-in cold room. For a lot of the shipments that we get ready, we have to stage the shipments so that we ship everything out on a single day. And some of those shipments can be as big as 5,000 boxes. We store all of those in this room and stage them for shipping. We actually drive our fork truck around inside the room. You can see in this picture, I mean, Wayne has a heavy sweatshirt on, he has gloves on. It's like driving in Buffalo. Well, there's not as much snow. This is one of our walk-in freezers. We have four big walk-in freezers. This is full of boxed up clinical specimens ready to ship out to customers. This is actually just a packaging operation. You can see all these boxes back here with FedEx labels on them. It takes us, for some of the big proficiency shipments we do, where we'll ship out 5,000 to 6,000 boxes, it takes us about 3 weeks to get that shipment ready. And it takes about 4 days just to print out all the FedEx labels that we use. This is the FedEx truck we have kind of an army of FedEx trucks, one after another, that backs up to the back of the building. Now, one thing you're not supposed to look at, these arrows on these boxes that say this side up. Yeah, I've been asking these guys, you know, get me some pictures where the arrows are pointing the right direction. Okay, and this is our office building in Buffalo. This is what the building looked like five years ago. This was actually, it was an abandoned mansion sitting right next door to the company. Myself and my business partner, you know, we needed more office space. We bought this thing from the city. I mean, it was city owned. You can see in some of these top floor windows, the windows weren't even boarded up. I mean, this thing had sat like that for 30 years. It was pretty much gutted on the inside. We did a full-blown historic restoration. It took us over 2 years to do it. It cost us about $2.5 million. That's what the building looks like today. We recreated all of the exterior woodwork. We used mahogany for that. This porch here, this is kind of interesting. This porch is not historic at all. It's actually steel frame metal, and it's sheeted in a material called AZEC, which is basically PVC. But it does look historic. They just didn't make PVC back in 1875. This is a conference room in the building. Just to give you an idea, you can see the detail, the woodwork that we put into the building, coffered ceilings. This is actually an original fireplace. This building was originally built in 1875. This is an original fireplace. The conference table here and quite a bit of our furniture on the first floor, we had manufactured by a Buffalo company named Kittinger. They do custom furniture manufacturing. They do all the furniture for the White House. And I know Ray, their CEO, real well, and so we got a really good deal. So we've got Kittinger furniture in this place. All of the doors in the building, they're 8 foot tall, arch top doors. This is identical to what was there originally. I mean, there were still a couple of the original doors left. We pulled those out. We found remnants of the original trim work, the original baseboard. The company that we had to do all this stuff, these guys, they make all their own shaper and router blades, so they can replicate anything. All of the interior woodwork in this building is all cherry. This shows you some of the detail on the staircases. All of the we have 16 offices in the building. I mean, this is one of the PhD's offices. All of our PhDs have offices in the building. And this just gives you a feel for what the building looks like. I mean, we sconces on the walls, nice staircases. This is the second to third floor staircase. So when I get to work in the morning, I go up this set of stairs, and then I go up this set of stairs because my office is on the third floor. I do that 50 times a day. I highly recommend it. It beats Pilates. Okay, now the building in Buffalo, this was actually a qualified historic restoration. This, we sit on the side of Main Street that's in a community called Allentown, which is a designated historic district. And actually I saw that Eureka College is a designated historic district. Now the building, like a lot of the buildings here on campus, it's now listed on the National Registry of Historic Places. We've actually been given several awards for the work that we've done on this. And I mean, this is an award that we got this last year from the Big Western New York Preservation League. This is kind of interesting. This is the county executive signature. This is the mayor of Buffalo's signature, where they declared August 11th, 2011, ZeptoMetrix Corporation Day in Buffalo. Okay, so want to spend a little bit of time and talk about two high growth areas that we have. I can't go through all the different types of products. These are two high growth areas, and it'll give you a real feel for what our business is all about. The first is proficiency testing materials. Now, what proficiency testing materials are, all clinical laboratories have to comply with a set of regulations called the CLIA regulations. So hospital laboratories, medical center laboratories, I mean, Quest Diagnostics, LabCorp, they all have to comply with these regulations. One of the requirements is that you have to show that you're proficient. You have to show that you know how to run the tests that you're running. And the way that this works is that a clinical lab, they'll contact an organization. I mean, the biggest in the US is the College of American Pathologists. So if I'm doing cholesterol tests in my laboratory, I'll contact the College of American Pathologists. I'll say, I'm doing cholesterol testing. I want to be part of your cholesterol proficiency program. And I pay them a few hundred dollars a year to do this. A few times a year, they're going to send me a box of specimens. And I don't know what's in the vials in the box. They're labeled 1 through 5 or 1 through 8 or however many are in the box. So I take those into my lab. I run those. I take the data from that, I send it back to the College of American Pathologists, and then they send me a report card based on how well I did. And if I did real poorly, they're going to call me and tell me, you got a real problem, you know, can you fix it yourself or do you need help? Because I mean, they do provide consulting services for labs. So that's how a proficiency program works. Now, that little box of specimens that the lab receives 3 times a year, the College of American Pathologists and the other people that participate in these proficiency programs, they don't make that box and they don't make the specimens. They contract all that work out, And right now, today, ZeptoMetrix handles almost all of the infectious disease products. In fact, the College of American Pathologists, QMPLS, a lot of the other organizations that are in this field, if they're thinking about putting together another proficiency program for a new infectious disease, I mean, they call us first. And so this is actually, it's been, the whole field of infectious disease diagnostics has been growing, you know, like crazy. I mean, you know, 10 years ago, we didn't get tested for flu. I mean, you know, you come into the doctor, you know, they didn't have good tests for influenza. And so, you know, you may or may not get sent home with an antibiotic, but, you know, there really wasn't any testing for it. You know, today you've got very good tests for all this stuff. And the diagnostic companies, they're testing for more and more organisms all the time. And so this has been a big growing area for us. Yeah, the other area that's been a big growth area for us is the whole area of molecular medicine. And I mean, it's a fairly new field. And to really understand it, I need to explain just a few basic concepts about DNA to you. Probably a lot of you already know it. I mean, it's covered in all biology classes these days, but just in case, it's time for DNA 101. Okay. This is what DNA looks like. And it's a helical molecule, and you see these things here. These are called base pairs. Okay, there are four different types of bases in this molecule, and they're arranged in different sequences. Okay, that's what makes DNA our genetic material, are those sequences. Okay, what did I do wrong? Where's the computer geek? Ah, there we go. Okay. Actually, I thought this was really cool. I found an animated GIF and I pasted it onto a thing, and there's absolutely no point to this slide other than PowerPoint is really cool. Now, all of our cells contain DNA. All living organisms contain either DNA or RNA, because some organisms, like some viruses, actually use RNA as genetic material. The DNA in our body, and this is just to give you an idea of how complex this is, the DNA in our body contains 3 billion of those bases, okay? Now, if I took a cell out of Dave's body, you wouldn't miss one, would you? Okay. If I took a cell out of Dave's body and I took the DNA out of that cell, you know, it's in a number of different fragments, but if I stretched it out and I laid those fragments end to end, the DNA from that cell would be about 6 feet long. Okay, so, and that's all packaged up inside a single cell. Now, think about this. We have about 100 trillion cells in our body. Okay, that's approximately 7 times as many cells as the national deficit has dollars. Okay. You know, which is a lot. But if I took all the DNA out of your entire body and laid the DNA out and stretched it out, that would reach from the Earth to the Sun and back 600 times. I mean, that's how complicated all of this stuff is. Now, when I left Eureka College, you know, I went into immunology and molecular biology. Back in 1975, you know, I told you there's a sequence of bases in that DNA. We didn't know how to sequence DNA. We also didn't know how to clone DNA. And another major advance in with DNA is something called PCR, which I'll hit in a second. Now, DNA sequencing, I mean, this is what the sequence, basically your four bases are adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanosine. And this is what a DNA sequence would look like, okay? The DNA if I took the DNA sequence, a 3 billion stretch of DNA from a single cell, and I printed up a paperback book doing this, that paperback book would be about 200 feet thick, okay? Now, in 1977, that's when people first figured, and that was actually my third year of grad, or second year of grad school, that's when people actually first figured out how to sequence DNA, okay? It was first automated in 1986. And then in the late 1980s, the National Institutes of Health, which is part of the US government, and the corresponding agency in Great Britain, they teamed up on a project called the Human Genome Project. And they said, okay, we're gonna sequence the entire human genome from somebody. And it took them 13 years to do that. It cost them $3 billion to do it. It involved several hundred researchers, I mean, pretty much working around the clock to get this done. And it was a massive project. And, you know, there were some surprises from that project. And one of the surprises is that our DNA from person to person is 99.99% identical. I mean, there are not huge differences from one person to another at the DNA level. Another, you know, thing that is also surprising is our DNA is 95% identical to chimpanzee DNA. I mean, it could be 96 or 97% for some people, but it's 95 on average. Now, things that surprised us a lot, only 5% of the DNA actually codes for proteins, okay? One other big surprise, 8% of the DNA that we've got in our cells actually came from viruses. You know, as we've been infected with viruses over the years, a lot of times viruses will leave behind pieces of their nucleic acid that get incorporated into our cells. 8% of our DNA came from viruses. I mean, there were some real surprises to this whole project. And you know, at the time, in 2003, when they finished this, they said, man, you know, it sure would be nice to, you know everybody's genome, because I mean, we could do a lot in terms of predictive medicine and all sorts of things. Well, the goal right now, and we're only a few years away from this, the goal right now is to be able to sequence somebody's genome in 24 hours for less than $1,000. And we're very close to being able to do that. I mean, think about that, 13 years, $3 billion, you know, here we are, less than 10 years later, 24 hours for less than $1,000. So, you know, in the not too distant future, if we want to, we're going to be able to know our entire genome. And that's going to raise a lot of issues. I mean, it's going to raise a lot of ethical issues. It's going to raise a lot of legal issues. I mean, you know, think about what happens when the insurance companies get involved. Oh, well, you've got a base substitution on chromosome number 13. We're not insuring you. Yeah, this is going to cause some major issues when this does happen, but it really is pretty amazing. I mean, we're going to be able to predict who may come down with particular diseases. You know, we also may be able to predict, you know, who's going to be 4 feet tall and who's going to be 8 feet tall, things like that. But you know, in the not too distant future, we're going to know everybody's sequence. DNA cloning was the next major thing that came along. DNA cloning, basically all it is we have the ability now to cut DNA out of one organism and paste it into another organism. It's real widely used. I mean, we use it a lot at ZeptoMetrix to construct different things. It's used, one place you see it, and actually the first drug that was made this way was insulin. The guys that actually came up with the technology to be able to cut and paste DNA, they actually formed a company named Genentech. And Genentech's first product was insulin, which is now marketed as Humulin by Eli Lilly. It's also used a lot in research. I mean, there are a lot of, one of the areas that it's used a lot in is the area of transgenic animals. I mean, we actually have constructed mice strains where that we've cut and pasted DNA into those mice. And conceivably we could do that with humans. Now, third area is PCR. And this is really where it gets into a lot of the heart and soul of what we're doing at ZeptoMetrix. PCR is short for polymerase chain reaction. It was invented in 1983 by a guy named Kerry Mullis. Kerry Mullis is an absolute maniac. I mean, this guy, after he invented PCR, decided to retire from science for 10 years and become a surfer. Seriously. The way PCR works, I mean, when a cell in our body gets ready to divide, the first thing it does, it replicates its DNA. You know, then the cell can split. You got two cells with the exact same DNA. What PCR is we can replicate DNA in a test tube. I mean, that's what Kerry Mullis figured out how to do, is how to replicate DNA in a test tube. And, you know, most people think, well, you know, what's the big deal? Okay, so you replicate the DNA. This is the big deal. You can start with a single piece of DNA, and if you replicate it, you end up with two pieces. You replicate it again, you end up with four pieces. You replicate it again, you end up with eight pieces. If you replicate it 35 times, you end up with 68 billion pieces. Now, I can't do much with one piece of DNA. I mean, I can't detect one piece of DNA, can't analyze it, I can't sequence it, I can't really do anything with it. You give me 68 billion pieces of DNA and I can do a whole lot. And so this is really what PCR is all about. The first place it got used is, of course, by the government. PCR is widely used in forensics these days. I mean, you can take a microscopic blood droplet, you can extract the DNA out of it, you can replicate the DNA, you can analyze it, and you can say, OJ was there. You know, I mean, that's how they do this. You can actually go to a crime scene, and if you find a single hair, there's enough DNA in that hair that you can, using PCR, tell who it came from. I mean, it's amazing technology. It really is. A lot of the victims of 9/11, fragments of their bones and things were actually subjected to PCR. That's how they identified a lot of the victims. And actually, New York State passed legislation. Anyone in New York State who's convicted of a felony or a penal misdemeanor automatically gets a DNA sample taken. So they're starting their own DNA database. So, you know, if somebody's convicted of a crime in New York, they get out of jail, they go to commit a crime someplace else, they lose a hair, they're going to get caught. Now, this is widely used today in infectious disease diagnostics. I mean, using PCR, you can take a blood specimen, you can take a urine specimen, whatever. You can theoretically detect one virus or one bacteria. And so, you know, if you pull a blood specimen out of somebody, you detect one HIV particle, they're infected. You know, I mean, 10 years ago, you couldn't do this. I mean, this is widely used. And whenever you do any kind of diagnostic test, I mean, one thing you need as part of the test is you need what's called a positive control, which is a sample that's going to come up positive. For PCR, the only good control is a tube of stuff that has some virus in it or bacteria, depending on what the assay is. So at ZeptoMetrix, I mean, what we've done At ZeptoMetrix, what we've done is we've developed some methods where we can inactivate viruses and bacteria, we can stabilize them, and these are intact organisms, their DNA and RNA is intact, they're non-infectious, and the refrigerator stable. We've actually filed some comprehensive patents on this stuff, and we're actually, and this is a material, we're supplying these materials to pretty much every diagnostic company in the world. And if you look at pretty much anybody's PCR assay on the market today, it's got our control materials in it. This has been a huge, we started selling these products in 2004. In 2004, we sold $10,000 worth of the product. In 2005, we sold $20,000 worth. It's been doubling every year. And we're going to sell about $5 million worth of these things this next year. Now, I mentioned, you know, you can use them for PCR controls. These are also very good for those proficiency panels that I mentioned earlier. Clinical laboratories use these to validate their assays. They use them to train their technicians. They use them for quality control materials. And a lot of diagnostic companies use them in their laboratories because it's a safe way to develop a new diagnostic test and not have to handle an infectious agent. So, actually, I'm going to skip over this. I mentioned DNA cloning. With some organisms, we've actually cut and pasted DNA from one virus into another to create synthetic controls. And the reason being that there are a lot of viruses like hepatitis viruses, papillomaviruses, things like that, that don't grow in culture. And so we have a tough time getting a hold of large quantities of these things. So we actually just cut and paste the DNA, cut and paste it into a virus that does grow real well. Most of the time we'll use mouse viruses for that because we want to use viruses that you don't find in the human system. And so we do a lot of work like that. Now, before I close, a few tips. Dave asked me to give people some pointers just in case anybody's thinking about starting their own business. You know, one of the first things when you get ready to start a business, or if you are even running an existing business and haven't done this, and it really is, it's important to define your business. I mean, you know, right now, ZeptoMetrix, we're an infectious disease company, we sell products to scientists. I mean, that's how we define our business. And just to give you an example of why that's important, back in 1900, the biggest businesses in the world were the railroads. You know, all of the railroads, you know, everybody's heard of the railroad tycoons. I mean, they had tons of money, highly successful businesses. But they defined their businesses as railroad businesses, okay? Now, where are the railroad companies at today? You know, does anybody know of a railroad company that's doing well today? You know, they're not. You do? Who's that?
Burlington Northern Santa Fe.
Okay. But for the most part, the railroad companies are not doing well today. Yeah.
In years past, you never heard you never saw or heard advertisements like you do today. CSX.
CSX?
You hear it in every media.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. A few years ago you never heard them advertise.
Yeah, yeah.
And now it's, well, we're still in business and we're still hauling and we still like to make money from it. So please sell your stuff.
This is true. Okay, think about this. Back in 1900, what if one of the railroad companies had said, we're not a railroad business, we're a transportation business? You know, I mean, 1900, that's when the automotive industry was in its infancy. The airline industry was getting ready to start. I mean, you know, railroad companies back in those days, if they had defined their business differently, their outcomes could have been a lot different than they were. I mean, that's just a classic example. I mean, that's one that you'll hear in business schools. But definitely, define your business. You know, focus. You know, I work with a lot of scientists and engineers up in Buffalo from the university and Roswell Park and places like that, you know, who want to start businesses or who have started businesses. And scientists and engineers are really bad about this. You know, they got something really neat and they want to start a business, and so they start the business and they're work until the next neat thing comes along. And then they kind of put this one aside and they say, wow, this is really neat. And they work on it. I mean, you have to focus. I mean, you really do. You know, to a certain extent, you just have to put blinders on and drive ahead. I've seen a lot of people that, you know, they struggle for years and years and years and really never go anyplace just because they keep jumping from one thing to another. You know, third, I mean, definitely be prepared to sacrifice. I mean, you know, the first year or so after I started ZeptoMetrix, yeah, I pretty much paid for everything with credit cards. I mean, I lived off my credit cards. I did learn that I'd forgotten how good ramen noodles really are. You know, now you can feed yourself for about $1 a day. But no, definitely be prepared to sacrifice because it is tough and it does take money to start a company. You know, don't expect help from the government. I mean, you know, you'll hear a lot of things about, well, you know, we've got tax credits for new business. Well, you know, tax credits are only good if you're making money. And new businesses don't make money. So, you know, I mean, don't expect a lot of help from the government. I mean, the biggest help that we got at ZeptoMetrix from the government is when we did that historic restoration on that mansion. We got tax credits because it was a historic restoration. I mean, you know, the government helped us almost nothing at all in the early going. So, you know, really, don't expect the government to give you a lot of help. You know, definitely do get help when it comes to legal issues and accounting issues. I had a friend of mine lately, he ran into a guy who was a real expert in the bar and restaurant area. And so these guys together, they bought a pub close to the Buffalo Bills Stadium, and they got a bunch of other friends to chip in investment money. And so they got this pub off the ground, and you know, it's a cool place. I mean, half the bartenders are Buffalo Jill's cheerleaders, and they call it the Rock Pile, which is the old name for the stadium. But you know, then the guy who's the expert on the bar and restaurant industry comes back and says, well, we're out of money, we need more money. And you know, everybody's saying, well, you know, we put a bunch of money in, where'd it go? Well, I don't know where it went. You know, it's gone. We need more. And so, you know, everybody's starting to think, well, it's time to talk to my lawyers. You know, the lawyers are saying, well, you know, do you have a receipt? No, I don't have a receipt. You know, do you have stock certificates? No, I don't have stock certificates. And so, you know, the lawyers are basically telling them, guys, we can't help you. You know, so definitely, you know, when you put a company together, I mean, get some legal help, get it incorporated the right way. If you've got multiple people involved, be sure it's legally spelled out who owns what, the whole shot. I mean, you know, you're going to get in a lot of trouble if you don't do that. The other place is definitely get some accounting help. You know, I mean, everybody thinks that the TSA guys at the airport are bad. The IRS is a whole lot worse than they are. You know, get some accounting help. Make sure your numbers are right. You know, be careful with investors. you know, it's like my business, myself and a business partner own the company. Okay, we're 50-50. Yeah, that's great. I've seen a lot of people start companies and they bring an investor in, just like I did. They're 50-50 owners. They get a little ways down the road. They say, you know, I need some more investment money. So they bring another investor in, and the other investor puts some money in, and suddenly their ownership is below 50%. And they're not their boss anymore. They don't own the company anymore. They don't control the thing. You know, be careful with investors. There are a lot of wolves out there. I mean, you know, I guarantee the minute you start your own business, you're going to have people coming up saying, you know, I'm an expert consultant. I can help you write a business plan, and I can help you go find investment money. And I'll only charge you $20,000. You know, I mean, you know, you see things like that left and right. You know, I'll rent you space, and I'll only charge you a certain amount. You know, I mean, the minute you start a business, everybody wants to make money off of you. I mean, you know, my personal feeling is if a lot of these people were that expert at these things, they'd have their own businesses. And then, you know, finally, know your customers. I mean, you know, there's an old saying from Henry Ford, you know, and, you know, it's not good enough to ask your customers what they want. You have to know your customer. And Henry Ford said, if I'd asked my customers what they want, they'd have said, they want a faster horse. So, okay, now, it costs money to start a company. You know, the three major sources that everybody goes to, first is your own money. You know, and if you can fund your own startup, I mean, definitely do it. You know, no matter how much it might hurt, do it. Then there are the three F's. The three F's are friends, family, fools. Yeah. Although the fools, there's not a lot of stupid money left out there. I mean, in the past, there were a lot of people, they had a lot of money, they'd throw it at just about anything that came along. There's not a lot of that left. So, you know, typically it's friends or family here. And then, you know, you do have angel investors. I mean, you know, if you're lucky enough to come across somebody who's wealthy, somebody who believes in your idea, somebody who's willing to put some money in, and, you know, that's what happened to me. I mean, when I got together with Chris is an angel investor. You know, have some good answers to these questions. I mean, who's going to buy my product or my service? What are they willing to pay? And can I deliver it at a profit? You know, a lot of companies, they don't think these things through. One of the things that they ground into us when I was at Bear Hunter Mannheim, and we started on new projects and new business ventures, is they told us, you know, before you do anything, just assume the whole thing's going to work. Look at what it's going to look like after it works, and then ask yourself, are you able to put all that in place? Because, you know, it's very easy to develop a product that you can't manufacture. You know, it's very easy to develop a product that, you know, you might not be able to sell because you don't have the sales channels. So you know, I mean, definitely work through that. And then finally, I mean, this is my last slide. The things that make a business successful, they're very rarely the things that the people who started the business knew about up front. I mean, you know, today, you know, our big growth areas, you know, like I said, are our proficiency business and our molecular diagnostics business. Back in 1999, I didn't even know we'd be doing that stuff. So you know, and that's, and you know, by the same token, the things that make you fail are rarely things that you're going to know about. A while back, I read a really good book. It was by a guy named Bo Peabody. Bo started a company named Lycos.com. And when he started Lycos, he set up an internet site that incoming first and second year college students could go to. They could trade, buy, and sell textbooks. They could get help with different things. I mean, it was an interactive site really for people entering college. I mean, that was what his vision was. You know, he got some investment money together, hired some software engineers, and so that's what they were doing. About 2 years into the whole thing, one of his software engineers came in one morning and said, hey, you know, I've got this slick little program I developed that it lets people create their own website. You know, can I throw this up on our website? And, you know, we'll see if we get any interest. And so suddenly, their subscribership started doubling every day. They eventually ended up selling the business to, Bo's business was named tripod.com. They ended up selling the business to Lycos for $89 million. And this, it's a slick book. It's short read, maybe 120, 130 pages. He goes through some things that I've never seen any place, like some of his management techniques. He had one episode where all his software engineers were fighting and arguing with each other, and the whole thing was just kind of coming unraveled. And so he called them all into the conference room. He's trying to get them to calm down. And finally, you know, he's at his wit's end, so he broke out crying. And everybody looks at him, and they're like, Bo is crying. And, you know, they were also concerned about Bo because they thought he was losing it, and they wanted to, you know, sympathetic. And they totally forgot that they were in a big fight with each other, and so that fixed the whole thing. You know, I mean, I've studied a lot of management techniques. I've never seen crying until I read this. Yeah, but definitely, you know, if you're going to start your own business, it's a neat book. It gives you a lot of insight from a guy who really went through a lot of the same type of nonsense that I did, although I never had to resort to crying. At least not yet. Actually, you know, here's contact info. Anybody who, you know, if you're thinking about starting your own business, you know, or investing in a business, you know, you just want to kick things around and talk about things, I mean, feel free to contact me. I'd be glad to help you. So, thank you.
Thank you. We have just a little bit of time for questions. Any questions from the audience?
As an international business, when you are doing HIV testing and other type of testing and materials for that, I'm thinking about developing countries in Africa, Asia. Mm-hmm. Do you have any partnerships with the companies in those countries that are thinking about expanding?
You know, actually, we're doing work. We've done quite a bit of work with companies like OraSure and ChemBio, who manufacture rapid HIV tests. And we actually supply them with quite a few control materials. And I know they're pushing to get into those markets. I mean, a lot of U.S. companies and European companies are afraid to go into those markets, you know, partly because, you know, there really isn't any money there. And, you know, partly because, you know, even if they find places with money, a lot of times it's hard to get paid. And you know, those are really the countries that you know, need the testing more. I mean, that's where your high prevalence rates are. So, but no.
You mentioned earlier the FDA regulation that you have to adhere to here in the States. Are you know that anything different when you're selling out of the country?
Actually, you are. If you're selling licensed diagnostic products into Europe, they've got their whole own approval system. It typically goes through the Paul Ehrlich Institute for approval, as opposed to going through the FDA. You know, you also have to get what's called CE marking, and to get CE marking, a lot of companies will set up an office in Europe. You know, either that or they'll closely collaborate with a company in Europe. I mean, you know, you almost have to have feet on the ground in Europe to get CE marking. The European system, it's not as rigorous as the U.S. system, but it's a very comparable system. You know, typically if you've got FDA approval on a product, it's pretty easy to get it through the Paul Ehrlich, but you know, then you still have to wrestle around with the CE marking, so. You know, it actually is. I mean, the Canadians, again, if you've got an FDA-approved product, it's very easy to get it into Canada. I mean, it really is. You don't even have to have the CE marking to get it into Canada. We're right across the river from Canada. Yeah, I mean, I can throw up the truck of my car if nothing else. And, you know, I hope they don't stop me at the border. I didn't know that was there.
Okay, thank you again. Mm-hmm.